meeting for the Rosary Catholic Church. That Becky joined us, and Becky, a number of years ago, when I was serving my secretary of assignment at Texas now, which is Becky and I, we both got out of Rosary on the same time, and she flew back home, and I was sitting there, and so we immediately bonded with each other, and what we bonded over was prayer. Becky is a woman of profound prayer. She has a profound relationship with Jesus Christ. And I'm grateful because each one of us in this church, each one of us in the church, we're all different members of the body of Christ, and we all have a gift to offer each other. And one of the things that I struggled with whenever I left LSU and got to Aloysius was going from ministering with a bunch of 18, 19, 20, 21-year-olds to ministering to women, with families, with grandkids, with kids, broken marriages and good marriage, all these different things that was just so different from LSU. In LSU, I had these students who were on fire for Jesus and had all the time in the world to pray holy hours every day and go to daily mass and pray the rosary and go to praise and worship sessions and do Bible studies. And then I got to Aloysius where I encountered women who at one point in their life were able to dedicate a lot of time to Jesus. And then in this new season of their life, they were married, they had kids, they had jobs, and they were struggling to pray. And I didn't know how to help them, because all I knew was my experience at Aloysius. And then comes Becky, right? A woman who is a wife, and who is a mother, and who herself went through the adolescent phase of encountering Jesus and falling in love with the Lord, and having a beautiful time for prayer, and then getting caught up in just the busyness of life, the busyness of marriage, busyness of family, of work, and of ministry. And through her experience, she was able to not only make time for God in the busyness, but she was able to articulate and communicate to me, to share with these women who I was walking with, ways for them also to make time for God in the busyness of their life. That was conducive for them, that didn't look like anybody else's spirituality, that didn't look like anybody else's relationship with Jesus. She was able to find ways to help people encounter God in a unique way that was specific to them. And I'm grateful because I think she's going to offer that same gift to each one of us here tonight. I know all you ladies have a lot going on in your lives. I know now is a busy season. Thanksgiving is right around the corner. Advent is right around the corner. Christmas is right around the corner. And unlike men, we just show up to stuff, you know? We don't put up the Christmas trees. We don't wrap the presents. We don't plan in advance. We just kind of come. Or we don't show up, and the other mad at us for not showing up. But y'all plan everything, and y'all organize everything, and y'all make sure everything happens. And so this is an extremely busy time in your life. And you might be in a place where you're like, oh, I just want to pray. So the Holy Spirit is going to take this time for Becky to come and join us. Help us pray. Help us to encounter God in the business of our lives. So, my sisters in Christ, please welcome my friend, and she will be yours tonight, Becky Eldredge.
Young man, you know, that I've heard by name all And so this is last January, and like Father Jeff said, I'm a mom of three. Chris and I have been married 6.5 years, and we did our little morning powwow, right? This is the day in January. Chris and I did our little morning powwow of like going through like, okay, you got this one going there, okay, and you got this one with different cat, okay, and you're picking that one up here. And at that time, we were also caregiving for my grandfather, who had terminal brain cancer. And so in this day of cleaning in our morning powwow, we were worried about the three kids and kind of getting them where they needed to go. We were worried about my granddad and how to get to his care. And then that same day, later that afternoon, I was going to be heading into New Orleans to speak and give a workshop. And so as you think, it was a full day. Like I knew it was a full day. Well, Chris leaves, he takes our youngest Mary, who's three, who Father Josh on more than one occasion possibly picked up out of the congregation and brought up to calm her while she was crying. But Chris brings Mary out the door. I get the older two kids on the bus. And when I get to this point in my morning, I feel like I need a gold star. Like, where's my adult sticker? The kids are back where they need to go. Anybody else there?
Okay,
God bless the women with cancer still left. picking up, I'm sorry. But I opened it up, and this article is talking about the impact of those two numbers we just named on our brains and on our life. And here was this startling research. It was one of those moments, like, I closed the magazine and I kind of hurled it because I was like, holy cow, I don't really want to acknowledge the truth of what this is. And what it says is, for every one of those that comes in, email, text, disruption, it takes us 15 minutes to refocus. So imagine those of you, I mean, think of even 25 emails, 25 texts, and every one that comes in, we pull out of our focus, and it takes us 15 minutes to refocus. And so what the article is saying is that this is having major impact. Show of hands, who in here is tired? Okay, Julie, anybody tired? your pastor said it's good. Anybody have trouble falling asleep? Look around at you. Who has trouble falling? Who has trouble staying asleep? Anybody wake up? I woke up in the middle of the night and I was writing a task list in my head. Like, Becky, don't forget you forgot to buy the daisy vest for Mary.
Whatever our work looks like.
to God, and none of these women, I'm not telling you to destroy any woman that's in here. But my friend and I have been doing drinks together, we got back and we walked down the hallway, and women are like grabbing and pulling us in the room to talk. They don't know what to do with the silence. Does anybody feel like that? I know I do even sometimes, and I talk about this for a living. It's hard to disconnect. It's hard to slow down. And all this for me means we are longing like crazy to make room for God in the middle of all of this. I want to say one little quick thing about our young people, because whether we are raising children or grandkids, or we have aunts, cousins, whatever, our young people, we have to pay attention, y'all. Part of this busyness, part of what we're talking about tonight is not only for us, but for our young people. Here, this is from my friend Roy Pettifus, who's a counselor down in Lafayette, Louisiana. The newest research out on our young people. Well, look at that. 1 in 8 depressed, 1 in 4 facing anxiety, 1 in 4 self-injury, and they are 70% sleep deprived. Mm-hmm. Guess how many people raise your hands in here? We, too, are as sleep deprived as our young people. This is our reality, and we have to name what's going on so that we can be very real about how we go about making room for God in business. Y'all with me? That makes sense so far, huh? Mm-hmm. Yeah, so here's the question. Do we believe that in the middle of everything that we made, all that busyness, the suffering of our young people, do we believe that God wants for us?
He sure does.
Do we believe that God is longing for every single one of us? Longing for us to be in the church? Yes. And that is a key question I want us to keep talking about tonight. Is God longing for us? And one of my favorite scriptures is the story of Zacchaeus. Right? Y'all remember that story? I'm not a teacher, but I think they should go to school. But you know, the little man short in stature. And what I love about this story is Jesus is coming through the town, surrounded by people. Like, Jesus was a busy person, y'all. He was busy. He had people that every time he went off to church, people tried to interrupt him constantly, right? But here he comes, and he's coming through the crowd. Thank you. all have deep longings within us. Deep longings that God meets us in. We're going to talk about what those are. And what I really love, one of my favorite saints is Saint Ignatius of Loyola, who we're going to talk about a little bit tonight. But probably way up there is Saint Mother Teresa. I still have to put the mother in. But what she said, through all of her work and all of her beautiful ministry in the streets of Calcutta, she said the basic, most deep human longing that I see, she said, was that we all long to love and to be loved. And think about your own life. Think about my life. I think how many times that is what we're deeply longing for. To be loved deeply by someone. To also love in return. Right? The longing, the deep human longing of our life. So let me tell you some of this amazing good news. Do y'all know we throw that word around all the time, the good news? Do y'all ever wonder what the good news actually is? We're going to talk about the good news tonight. One of the good news, pieces of our good news is, when we feel that longing, it is our wake up. And the longing we might feel comes in different ways that we'll talk some more about, but sometimes it feels like restlessness. We sang that song, Audrey's Bad Song, right? My heart is restless. Has anybody ever, what little confession have felt restless ever in your life? Me? I'll feel it this weekend. How about a moment where you've ever felt yourself searching and seeking for more? And you can't figure out what it is. Anyone? Yeah? All these things, when we feel this, I want you to celebrate that moment of longing. It is the Holy Spirit waking you up to your longing for God. Celebrate it. Thank God for it. It is God within us waking us up. And I put up here a little, this is not our dog Hershey. But when I think about longing and how the Holy Spirit wakes us up, I often think about my little rescue puppy during the flood. She showed up during the flood in 2016. Little puppy, skin and bones, full of ant bites. And Hershey never barks. The only time she ever barks is when it's actually something I need to pay attention to. Right? The other day, she came to my back window and she's barking. And I'm like, what are you doing? I was by myself in the house and I start freaking out when the girl barks. So I'm like, what is going on? And true, there's a man in my backyard, right? Just wandering around, it's all good. But my point is, Hershey helps me wake up and pay attention. And one of the great gifts in our life, in our faith, is that we have this promised advocate of the Holy Spirit. And so the Holy Spirit is going to wake us up to our relationship with God. Isn't that kind of awesome? We're not in it by ourselves. We're not alone, y'all. So this longing that we feel is God's gift to us.
restless until they rest.
Restless until they rest in thee, O Lord, the great saint and blessed, the fountain of our church. Right? All saying the same thing, our scripture, our great wisdom from our saints, our tradition, and our theology, all saying the same thing. It is in God alone that our soul is at rest. God alone is going to satiate the longing. And the Holy Spirit is going to help us. Help us notice the longing, help us find our which is to live with God forever. God who loves us, God who gave us life. That's who we want to spend our days with, right? The one who loves us, the one who created us, the one who called us. The goal of our life is to live with that person. That's the first part of what Ignatius says. And the way all this longing sort of shows up in our lives. Our wake up call is when we feel ourselves longing and searching for more. It is when, I mean, an hour ago, I still say it to Chris. And I'm like, this is the person I'll expect. And I'm like, you know, it's like, there is something more that I feel like I'm yearning for, and I don't know what it is. Right? And it happens when we first are being drawn into a relationship with God. And then when God is inviting us to a more intimate relationship, or try a new, deeper way of relationship with God, we are going to feel the same longing. And I guarantee you, I'll have 20 years today, if you need to work for this one. And I know I have to. This longing for God. And at the same time, God is longing for us, so the Holy Spirit awakens within us this longing so that we can make a turn and step towards God. Right? So that's one longing, right? God longing to be in a relationship with us. Another longing is God longing to free us from sin. And again, here's the beauty and the gift of the Holy Spirit in this morning. This is when we feel that good old Catholic guilt. The good kind of guilt. Not the guilt that makes us all cuckoo, right? But the guilt that's like the stain of conscience or remorse or we feel sorrowful. When we feel that in our lives, those things that might bring us towards the sacrament of reconciliation. That is, again, the gift of the Holy Spirit in our lives, waking us up to something that is keeping us from a relationship with God, inhibiting our growth in God. So if you look at the principle of foundation, it talks about, look at paragraph 3, kind of 2 and 3. Paragraph 2 talks about how everything in the world is a gift to help us get to know God. And these gifts help us develop as loving persons. Right? The people that God has created us to be, the women and men that God has created us to be. But it says, look at the bottom two sentences of the third paragraph, that if any gift becomes the center of our life and displaces God, we hinder our growth towards our goal. And what is our goal? What is our goal? To live with God forever, in the here and now, and on our walk to eternity. And so when sin comes in, what happens is we take that gift and we knock God out of the center of that life. And we put a gift in our life there instead. Right? And it might be the gift of ambition. It might be the gift of organization. It might be a relationship in our life. It might be our work. It might be our finances. Y'all, we could go on and on with the things that accidentally, whether we mean us or not, but somehow end up knocking God out. And let me tell you from my own life experience, because we're talking about making a lonely life, and a tired and not old, is when God is not the hub of the life. The life. And the places where I can be really guilty sometimes and not mean to is sometimes it'll be trying to put my husband as the center, right? Which is so unfair to him. It's like trying to make Chris be the one that holds all our worth and value, right? Or, you know, it's like I'm putting all this pressure on him to make me feel all comforted and all that. But that is so not fair, you know, to him. Or to anyone that we would put in front of. But it's God at the center, not the gift, that continues to help us develop as a loving person as God. And God longs to free us from that, so that when we accidentally knock a gift into the center of our life, the Holy Spirit too, besides wanting to free us from sin, to enter our brokenness. And I'm talking about brokenness that comes not necessarily from our sin, but from things that just happen in life, that are beyond our control. Things that all we have to do is turn on the news, reopen the newspaper, and read about. When God longs to enter this, and this is where on the principle of salvation it says, everything has the potential of calling forth in us a deeper response to our life. Even the flood, even betrayal, even death, even a sickness. Whatever it is, even a relationship struggle, that even that God can use and to end it today. Amazing things happen. I was just on college just before we started. There was a dark part season of my life that I am blown away still how God is redeeming and using it for good. Right? And so God is going to woo us and keep seeking us, you know, to enter so that He can become part of it. Right? The longing, God longs to enter that. And God also, the fourth way I want to talk about, the fun way of how God longs for us, is God longs for our yes. And this is yes in the sense of being sent forth, being called to act, being called to put one of our gifts into play. And this is the very bottom one where it says, our only desire and our one choice should be this. I want and I choose what better leads to the deepening of God's life in me. And so we will feel this kind of longing of God having a birthing invitation in our life. Sometimes it kind of feels like this wrestling field. Like the angel, you know, when Jacob's wrestling with an angel, you know? I love to wrestle with God when He tries to put a new invitation in my life. I like to put the He's put the accelerator on and I'll put the brake. But the longing, that restlessness is only going to keep building until we finally say yes to God and to what God is asking of us. And I know several of y'all have read my book, Busy Lives, Restless Souls, and I can think of no better example. Moment on Monday night, where are you experiencing? And you go, there's a picture of it, and we go, the one I choose for you. Okay? Be still and know that I am God. Right? This morning, 5:30, I was drinking this cup of coffee, sitting in my little place of prayer, and it is that every day pausing to be with God and be still and know that He is God. It has literally changed my life. It has changed the trajectory. It's why I'm saying that here today. I never would have dreamed that this is what God is going to call us to. When we think about the gift of this, what I call innate is going to our inner child. And this is, I'll tell y'all, I haven't had the concept of it ever yet. This is my next book that's coming out in April on this very topic of the inner child. But what someone taught me in the middle of my college life, where I thought I was busy, is the thing that has changed everything about the rest of my life. And what Sister Illy is the one who taught me, is she taught me, first of all, that this inner chapel existed in the first place. And what the inner chapel is, y'all, is this space within each one of us. Everyone is happy where God is happy. And this means, this fundamental thing means, we are never alone. We are never alone. This is Emmanuel. We are about to profess this like crazy in Advent. God is with us. Do y'all hear that? We are not alone. God is with us. Say it to yourself a thousand times a day. Have to say it constantly. You're not alone. God is with us. So no matter what you are holding right now on Monday night, you are not by yourself in what you are holding. God has you. God is with you. God is with every one of us. This is my reason for hope in this world today. This is the good news our world needs more than ever. Amen?
Amen.
Let's look at how we embrace it. The inner chapel comes from, if I want you to think about, you know that all the awesome saint pictures everywhere. The inner chapel is not a new thing. It has been here through all of our scripture, right? The Old Testament, this is Moses, think of Abraham, think of Samuel here in the building of voice, think of Sarah, think of Hagar out in the wilderness after she gets rejected by Sarah. All of these people have leaned in on this gift of God with them, within their sacred space where only God resides. Jesus leaned on the gift of the inner chapel, right? We see Jesus praying and going into the quiet to be with the one who loved him, the one who gave him life, the one who called him. We see him all the time. This is the agony of our heart. One of the most poignant moments of Jesus believing in the power of his inner child. When we think about great saints, our great teachers of prayer in our Catholic tradition, we have people like Teresa of Avila, who calls this space her interior castle. Saint Ignatius of Loyola, his entire spiritual exercises are based on the fact of a person going daily to their inner child. Right? So our hope right now, who is a Jesuit and who has gone himself through taking people through the spiritual exercises of St. Ignatius of Loyola, meaning that he believes this inner chapel exists in the first place, right? That it's there. I put St. Catherine of Siena, she calls it in Greek her writings. These are, by the way, these women I'm talking about are three of our four women doctors in the church, right? So Catherine of Siena calls it her inner cell. When you talk about Therese and Jesus, the little flower, I believe, is that her here? Her cousin, right? Smack in the middle. Like she talks about, she'll go away into her inner room. So, or going into the silence so that God can speak to her. So again, this is not a brand new concept. And so we have to listen to Him, to ponder His words deep in our heart. We need to be alone with God in the silence to be renewed and to be transformed. Silence is what gives a new outlook of life. And in our world of busyness, in all the distractions we're facing, we need this gift of the energy of the Lord. And how do we embrace it and how do we get there? And when we think about what happens in the inner chapel, it's the same power that we watch emanate out of Jesus when somebody touches them in the gospel. When the crippled woman who is bent has an encounter with Christ, she is set free. When the woman who is bleeding, hemorrhaging from her life, throughout her life, touches His mere cloak, He says, "Who touched me?" Because He felt the power of God. And what I have learned in the last 2 decades of going to my inner chapel every day is the power of going there means the power of Jesus emanates to us. In the same way it did to us who watched Him in the Gospels. As He heals the withered hands, as He gives sight to the blind, as He sets captives free. That power is available to us every single day and every moment of our life. Isn't that amazing, right? Because we are not alone, y'all. We are not alone. That power is available to us through a relationship with Jesus Christ. A relationship with Him. Thanks for reading that. I'll talk about it. And if you read in Varieties, she writes to her sister, she says, there's going to be a moment in our life where we move from praying to God at any time to showing up every single day in an intentional way. And she says, it's time to go there. And I think right now, in 2019, it is time to go there. It is time for us to be intentional warriors, sisters of Christ, prayer warriors, and show up in an intentional way to our inner chapel. Our world needs it, our family needs it, our marriage needs it, our relationships need it, right? So when I think about how we get there, I brought my little cast iron up here. How do we do this? And when I want you to just think for a minute about cooking a gumbo, right? When we start with a Cajun dish, what are our three fundamental ingredients in almost all of our dishes? The Trinity, right? Our Holy Trinity, our Cajun Trinity, bell pepper, onion, and shell pepper. And when we think of our prayer time, and this is on that second sheet, the creating a spiritual plate, we have to have three fundamental ingredients of a time of prayer, a place of prayer, and a space of prayer. So what we want to do, which Teresa Battle said, which is to go from praying to God throughout all of our days, which means we need a set time of prayer, a set space of prayer, and we make it a sacred space. And our time, y'all, can be any time. It can be in the morning, it can be during the middle day of work, it can be sitting in a car in the traffic, it can be sitting in a carpool line, it can be sitting on the bleachers or whatever kid activity that we are waiting for the kid to finish, right? Any time will work. As long as it's set and it's intentional. The place, like I said, it can be anywhere, along with that time. Maybe it's in your home, maybe it's in my house, maybe it's the car, maybe it's the bathtub. It can be anywhere. And the way we make it a sacred space is we simply bring a few meaningful things in that help us remember what we're doing here. It's just basic, simple items, right? You go to my parents' place in the house, which is a chair. It simply has a Bible. It has a plaque that says, "Be still and know that I'm God." There's a crucifix. And right now, there's a picture of Mary. Because Mother Mary is key in my life right now. Has a lot. But we each need it. And then when you come back to the gumbo, when you think about all the different ways we would cook a gumbo, the different ingredients, right, that are passed on to us from our families or whoever taught us to make gumbo, we all have a unique flair. And what's awesome in our prayer life, in our Catholic prayer tradition, is we have all different kinds of ways to relate to God. And I think of them like all the little extras that would go in a gumbo. And so my way of prayer is no better or worse or whatever than somebody else's method of prayer. Right? There's all these different prayer tools. So what we need to discern is, what is the prayer tool God is inviting us to at this moment? And just do the one thing, and that's it. Just the one thing. So we have to move and help us figure out these moments. We can have this set time and space and place and show up to God every day with that set prayer. Right? And in your hand, one of the things y'all picked up tonight was the Give Us This Day that the Church of the Press makes in here for free. If you are drawn to Scripture and praying with Scripture, I highly recommend this prayer resource. It has a beautiful, I'm sure you've heard, I'm not going to go into this because I know Father Josh talks about Lesio Divina all the time, but you will see the Give Us This Day is a beautiful way of speaking in Scripture. So if you're looking for a prayer tool that would help you pray in Scripture every day, please use that. I get a subscription to this, so does my husband. It shows up in your mailbox every month. No excuses. It's right here. You go to your mailbox and it's there. My gift pack is another one, and your mama's is another one. Again, it doesn't matter which one. They're all good. Pick the one that works for you. If you're drawn to pray in the Scripture, right? If you're looking for a guide to pray in our daily Scriptures. The last thing I want us to talk about tonight is what to discover as we go to our inner chapel. What we discover as we go to our inner chapel is what I made the promise of God. The reason that this matters today is so that we can come to know the good news, which are the promises of God. When y'all come to Mass on Sunday, I want you to listen for how many times Father Josh talks about the promises of God. I guarantee you, you're going to hear of an opening prayer. You're probably going to hear of multiple times in the Eucharistic prayer, possibly in the closing prayer. And while there are literally thousands of promises of God in the Bible, the ones I want us to really look at very quickly are these. We've talked about the first one, the promise that we're not wrong. Right? When we go to the inner chapel every day and we believe that God is with us, we realize that promise that we are not alone exists. And with that promise that we're not alone is that we also belong to someone. We belong to someone who loves us, who gave us life, and who calls us. When we go to our inner chapel, receive that power from Christ by being with him in the inner chapel. Come to discover we are unconditional loved and we are offered mercy. We see too that we come to understand this friendship with Jesus. We have a model and a friend, that he is not a far-off person, but Jesus is as real to me as my husband. He is y'all. He's as real to me as my kids, as my best friend. He is that real to me. Spending time with him in my daily chapel. And it is available to every one of us. Every one of us can get to know him in this real and personal way. I think we discover we have a source of hope and light in darkness. And his other promise that we have this capacity for joy. Capacity for joy in him. Right? And we come to discover that as we have a relationship with God. As we put God at the center of our life, and as we listen to the one who calls us for our life of meaning and purpose, who to be in relationship with, and what gifts in our life. And the great thing is, all you have to do is look at Scripture, is to know that God can be trusted because God delivers on God's promises. promises God has made to the world, and they are for us. What is the promise that you need to remember right now? What is the promise that you need to cling to? The good news of our faith? And how do you want to go about making time for the one who loves you and who gave you life and who calls you, right? And that handout that I gave you about the spiritual plan is a way that you can intentionally put that into practice. Okay? You can talk about your time, your space, your place, your prayer method. There's lots of other questions on there about what kind of support do you need at this moment in your life to be in a relationship with God. To work on that end goal of our life. The goal of our life is a here and now goal and a goal for the rest of our life. What are the promises? So as we close, I'm going to just invite us into just a very simple prayer, and I'm going to guide us through, and then we'll move into the last song of my prayer. And this prayer method, I know Father Josh talks to y'all a lot about scripture, so this is just a different prayer method I wanted to just briefly teach you. It's called the examine, and on a handout, maybe Wendy, I think you should pass, some people pass on the prayer cards, but the examine is a way for us to pray and bring our entire life to God. It can take about just a few minutes to pray. And what the examine is it's a review of the last day of our life. That's it. It's taking the last 24 hours of our day and bringing them before God. And as we pray the examine, we are doing five things. We are doing, first, we're asking God to show us our day and God's will. The second thing, we're looking back with God's help, looking for all the things that we're thankful for. Third thing is, we're looking for the moments we felt God's presence. The fourth thing we're going to be looking for is, where did we feel the lack of God's presence in our life? Maybe the moments of sin, maybe the moments we felt away from God. And the fifth and final thing is, we're simply looking to the day when and asking God to be with us and bring in our next day before God. Right? I have a prayer card for you, so don't worry about writing down the steps. What I'd like to invite you to do is simply close your eyes, get comfortable, and we will move from our examine into our closing thought. So as you just simply sit still, rest, I invite you to go to your inner chapel. Thank you. gentleness, generosity. Talk to God about whatever arises in your hearts.
Behind you.